Importance of statistics can be understood by the popularity of these concepts. Statistics is the crucial and the important part of our everyday's life. And the statistics are used by students and the professionals as well to understand our data points intuitively. To keeping that importance in mind, we have came up with a tutorial, Central Limit Theorem, where you will learn about what is Central Limit Theorem and the what is the basics of sampling theorem as well. Right? So let's get started.
We are revising them, then Central Limit Theorem we'll get into, and then we'll get into hypothesis testing. So first, the point here is primarily about sampling. I think we covered this point of sampling last time, but we can revisit that one for just for 1 minute. So why do we need a sample? What are the reasons for us to look at a sample?
Because you may not be able to observe the whole population, and sample should be referring, you know, through sample statistic, we will be inferring to the universe or the population, right?
Brilliant. So we have basically sample is what most of the times that you can measure, you can observe, you can calculate, and you can start operating on. But at the end of the day, that particular sample has to be a representative of your population. The question is, whatever the metric you are calculating, whatever the assumption you are making based on that sample, is it representing my population or not, is a bigger question that we need to look at. So now the first question that I asked, we are talking of two types of statistics that we talked about. One is descriptive statistics. Second one is inferential statistics. All this while, we have been talking about descriptive statistics. In descriptive statistics, we are talking about the behavior of that particular sample, population, whatever you call, we are talking about that. So you say that, okay, the average of this sample is this much, the standard deviation of this sample is this much, or it has this much of a variation. So it is the distribution of this sample essentially is normal. It is not normal. It is a binomial distribution. You can talk about a number of things. At the end of the day, you are articulating certain behaviors, traits, or characteristics of that population. That's all. We are not going beyond about that particular one. But what do we do with all these statistics that we are talking about a given sample or population? You have to come to a conclusion or come to an insight which help you take a decision at the end of the day. If that is not the case, what is the point of having all this information? Are we in sync with this concept?
Yeah. So we are trying to infer the population parameter through using the sample statistic.
Yes. Right? Yes. So now you have all the statistics related to your sample. Now what we try and do is, whether the sample statistics are representative or synonymous with the population parameters. If this my sample is telling this much, can I go ahead and make an assumption? Can I go ahead and make a conclusion that this my population will also behave in the same way? So tomorrow I want to launch a product into the market. Complete national launch, complete throughout India, I want to launch one product. You can take any product at the end of the day, a fruit juice or some powder or talcum powder or shoes, something is being launched. You can take anything, there is no restriction on that one. When you want to do that, you cannot go and test your product in every nook and corner of the country and then I'll say, okay, then now I'll go and make a national launch. But you need to be very selective enough to ensure that you test at right places, and at the same time your test results can be inferred and applied to the whole nation. Then you can go ahead with national launch. That's the difference between your pilot and then your national launch that happens. Are you understanding the business inference, business application, where it matters now? Now let's say, for example, I'm launching a fruit juice, something, a fruity or anything else that's new juice that are coming up, API or anything that is being launched. I'll say let me check three characteristics: the sweetness, the flavor, freshness. I'm measuring three characteristics for my particular fruit juice. Now I select a particular market, let's say South India, and I launch the product in South India in four major cities that are there within South, and then I capture users' feedback, the pilot feedback on all these three parameters. With in each city, I'll test among 10,000 people. So I have 10,000, 10,000, 10,000 from four cities. Now I got for each parameter, I am measuring on a scale of 1 to 10. how sweet it is. Is the sweet is really good, the freshness is really good, and the third parameter we took sweet, freshness, and flavor. The flavor is good. So one indicates it's not at all good, 10 indicates it's very good. So we ask ratings on these of these particular things. We're capturing three different metrics. Each of these metrics, you can build a distribution of its own. Are we good with this? Now that once we do these three measures for these samples, it is, now can I go ahead and launch my product across the country? If I get all these things above 8, on an average, I'm getting 8 across 4 cities that I launched, can I go ahead and make a national launch?
Data may not be sufficient.
Data may not be sufficient. Exactly. Because my data is not representative enough. I have seen only a partial sample, a partial side of the thing. So I need to ensure that the sample that I am pulling is representative enough of my population. My population in India constitutes 29 states and 6 union territories, or 30 states and 6 union territories essentially. So if I'm taking only South India, 4 states, and represent that, the remaining part of India which I have not covered, I don't know whether they exhibit the same behavior or not. So my sample may not be representative enough. So now if I have to pull the sample and ensure that my sample's metrics or statistics are representing population metrics, the sample has to be pulled properly. That's where your distribution will help you to understand where it comes into picture. So when you pull the sample, you decide your sampling frame, what we call as, I'm getting a little technical right now, but I use only one or two terms. You get defined sampling frame. When you call a sampling frame, you identify which are regions in India, what are all the representative places I need to pick from, where I'm going to launch my product essentially when I launch this push to the nook and corners of India. If I measure in this place, I can cover this whole zone. If I cover these areas, I can cover the other zone. So let's say India is divided into 5 zones. I take 2-3 places in each zone, and at the end of the day, I'm capturing 20-25 places, and I have a representative representation from all dimensions, all nook and corners of India into my population. Then I do it, I can measure it, that's where it is. Still, I'm not covering whole India, but the sample is representative enough. That's why these two factors about time and effort factor will come into play. I select small population, part of the population, very small. So that saves my effort, that saves my time. At the end of the day, I go with still representing and measuring. So my sample would represent the population. Now, once I do this, then at the end of the day, can I go ahead and now that I got some representative places across the country and I did my survey like I talked about earlier and do that, can I still go ahead and say that this is a successful launch? This can be a successful launch. Can I make an estimate? Folks, are you with me?
Yes, John, but I'm not able to get the question.
Okay. See, my question, basically my question is, earlier when we talked about only South, 4 cities, we are clear that we are not representative of the country. Across the country, I selected from different zones, representative places where I think if I can get the perceptions from people about my juice across these places, let's say 25 places across the country, now I selected and I'm launching a survey about the feedback about this juice. I got all the data. The data is very positive. I'm very happy the results from this survey coming up. So can I go ahead and launch do a national launch? Because my test data, the samples that I got, the sample data is telling me that the results are good. Is it good for a national launch?
Because we have more representative samples, so we can probably believe the sample results, right?
That's one dimension, but there could be other dimension that we need to look at. Still, you have only your sample. Is the sample representative of the population or not? We need to measure that one, right?
That's a hypothesis we need to create and test it, right? Yeah.
Yes. So the hypothesis essentially is that now my samples that I have identified are representative enough of my population. I assume that the results of my test or representative of my population. That's the hypothesis that we go with. Right. So that's the hypothesis that we need to validate. So you calculated your mean, standard deviation, scores, variances, everything based on samples. Now you need to ensure that these are representative enough of your population. This is what inference going on. So I'm sample to population, whatever you try and extrapolate. So you're going from a known scenario to an unknown scenario and extrapolate the findings, inferences from your known information to an unknown information is called as hypothesis testing. That's what the inferential statistics is all about.
Yeah. So the inferential statistics mainly refers to the hypothesis testing, right, Ron?
Yes. Yes. Inferential statistics predominantly is around hypothesis testing. Should we move on? Any more thoughts, questions, clarifications that you have in mind at this point?
One question, Ram, so when during the entire session, we see usually in the examples and all the population mean and the population standard deviation is given, which in practical use case, I believe that getting a population mean or standard deviation is not easy, right? So
yes.
How the inferential yes. statistics actually works?
Yes. So in one of the videos, Abhinandan talked about when you don't know population statistics, how do you go about for example, in standard deviation, you do not know. So then you use the sample statistic.
That's a t-test.
T-test versus z-test. So you got a very good point. I think you're 2 steps ahead, but let me address the question because you asked it. Majority of the times, you would not know population parameters. In that scenarios, the curve, that the distribution that you're trying to build, can you be sure that it is a normal distribution? Why we need a normal distribution, we'll come to that when we talk of central limit theorem. But can we know that it is a normal distribution? We are not sure. Not sure. Then whatever you calculate for the matrix on that particular one and you identify the intervals essentially for that particular one, you are not sure what you are going to calculate. So you have to extrapolate this one. So what you essentially do is you become a little more conservative with your estimations when you work with sample. So because the populations, it's more get normalized. So if you deal with, let's say, a value of X for a population, when you take a sample, X may be representative, X may not be representative. So you try to be more stringent, more this thing. For example, let me say this. The same example that we talked about, the fruit juice. You're calculating for the sweetness. The sample that you got, for all the samples together, you got essentially is 8.5 is the sweetness rating that is out there with a standard deviation of 1.5. So what does that mean? What is the value that can oscillate between the sweetness of the juice?
Plus minus 1.5 standard deviation from the mean, right?
So how much that would be? On one end, it would be 7. On the other end, it could be 10. So the value should be between 7 and 10 predominantly. That's what your estimate should be at the end of the day. But that is for the sample. Any number of samples you pick, it could be like that. But would that 8.5 could be for your population? We do not know.
Maybe may not be. We don't know.
Maybe may not be. So, and you don't know population statistics. Then what we try to do is you increase the impact of standard deviation that you are trying to do. So you consider a higher standard deviation. You consider a lower mean. So there are ways to do that. So your standard deviation formula that you calculate at the end of the day, and there is another term that comes as degrees of freedom. So where you divide your standard error for your mean that you calculate is, you remember, you know the formula of the standard error that comes across in the videos?
It is the standard deviation by square root of n.
Square root of n. So basically, instead of n, you do n minus 1. So you increase the value of that particular one so that you do that. So the denominator, you tend to increase that n minus 1. There's a lot of factors called degrees of freedom and other pieces come into play there. And because by doing some statistical approximations, you tend to move from T distribution to a Z distribution, which is a normal distribution. Because the moment you make these edits, your T distribution tend to behave like a normal distribution. So then you feel that the sample statistics that you got, either mean or the other metrics like standard deviation, variance, any other things that you get, tend to behave for a normal distribution and represent a population. Right. So let's move on. So let's think about central limit theorem.
Ram, one question before moving here.
Yeah.
So the example that you gave of taking samples from different regions, like, are we saying that we had like five populations and five different samples?
No, you cannot have five populations. That's a different scenario. That's one of the important problems that we'll solve in the hypothesis testing. And when we talk of different types of hypothesis tests that we do, we will end up with a particular sample and another sample. So you have two samples that you are working around with. But the bigger question that you start tackling is whether these two samples belong to the same population or belong to the different population. That's the important question for us to tackle. We need to understand that dimension also when we solve this problem. So if there are hypothesis tests, so there is something called as a paired test, independence test, test of independent samples, test of paired samples. When you talk of a paired sample, it essentially means that it's the same population, but at a different points of time. Let's say, for example, you launch a product. What is the feedback about that particular product in the first 1 week? And it's the product is new. So people just tend to get a view of that product and they would not have got full exposure to that. So they give the initial perceptions. Now the product being used by the customers, let's say, for example, 3 months. At the end of 3 months, you go to the same set of people and then you capture their perceptions. So now that they have spent more time with that particular product, so are they feeling happy with that product? Are they more favorable with that product? Or now that they spend more time, they understood the problems or issues, challenges with that product and they are not very happy. So what is that? It's the same population I do, but I get different measurements. You're understanding where I'm coming from?
Yeah, I get that one. So, I mean, before we, let's say, going back to your problem, yeah. For us, we were planning to launch the product, right? So
yes.
I am... basically dividing the whole country into five different parts and each of it has its own hypothesis testing.
Right.
Is it not the case?
Right. But at the end of the day, if I launch nationally, I would also get a sense of in South, what is my average scores that would be like? In North, what would be my average scores like? There could be a benchmark that you compare against. So there could be a national, let's say, for example, take four regions for simplicity's sake. East, West, North, South, right? In four other regions. In East, the average score is 7.5. In North, the average score is 8. In West, average score is 8. In North, it is 7.8, for example. And in South, it is 8.5. And if I take average of all of these things, it could be somewhere around 8 because I'm ranging between 7.5 to 8.5. I'm not actually calculating. I'm just getting. So my 8 is my population mean at the end of the day. So now, My population mean at the end of the day is 8. In the sample only, we are still not looking at the original population. I'm taking all these samples picked up from different regions and calculated the holistic mean of that particular one, which stands at 8. Now, if I have to check that, is my East performing better than the overall population? Or is my North performing better than the population? I compare the 7.8 of North vis-a-vis the overall population mean. And you are launching, this, let's say, for example, Fruity has already been there in the market. Now you are launching a new version of Fruity. So you will compare your old benchmark data that is out there and you compare this value against your old population mean. And in scenarios where you don't have your original population mean, as we talked about, that's the point what Prasad raised. When you don't have that particular thing, how do you address? Then you try and come to a scenario where you convert your T distribution to a Z distribution by making changes in your formulas and everything so that your distribution tend to become normal and then your sample statistics will represent the population parameters. Bruno, I think you're not, Bruno or Chaitanya, I think somewhere I still feel that element of doubt there. Is that element clear? Did I answer your question?
Yeah, you did answer my question. The only thing is I'm still trying to understand the population as such, right? So now we are restricting ourselves to India. So let's say mine is an international product. Then
right.
Is it like extended across the world? The population becomes the world. Or
yeah. In that, at the end of the day, good question. At the end of the day, it is primarily pertaining to your population. What is your total population you are referring to? Let's say, for example, if Apple is launching a phone, for it, it's the whole world, all countries, wherever Apple is launching. Fruity, it could be India only. Maybe I launch a Priya pickle, it could be South India only. I don't see Priya pickle in North India. Maybe Mother's Dairy pickle or anything, maybe they launch across the country. There are different products which are So you define your population, what it is. At the end of the day, for you, when you launch your product, you define what your population is.
Okay. So that is defined by the person who is trying to...
Exactly. It's a business. The business has to understand what the population is, what my population is. So let's say, for example, I launch a website. Times of India website gets launched, or some news magazine website gets launched. Who are my audience? Depending on where I'm trying to do the population. As long as it is an internet, the whole world is my audience at the end of the day. I can do the test across all countries in the world. So you define your product. Let's say you're making one small product related to one small region in South India, North India, anywhere, and that product nowhere knows anywhere else about. Your population is very much restricted there. So you as a businessman, you as the one who is doing that exercise, you know what your population is. But the question which Prasad raised essentially is, tomorrow, initially when Apple launched iPhone, it was there only in US. It was not there in any of the other countries. Then Apple took over China, then it came to India, then it came to UK, then it went to Germany, some other country. And now it crossed across all continents and it is there in every country. Everyone is aspiring to own an Apple product. So now the market is whole thing. When it has started off, it's only one small region. Now the sample expanded. That's exactly the problem with population and why we don't know population statistics. Because your population can be ever expanding continuously. So you try and measure your statistics on your samples and you extrapolate your samples to your population through right statistical calculations. And that's where your inferential statistics play a big, big role for you.
Thanks, welcome, sir.
And when you go to supervised learning predominantly, what does supervised learning or any of the machine learning algorithms do? You take a data, you know what you expect, then it builds up. The supervised learning algorithms build a model essentially, where when a new data comes in, it treats data in such a way and it classifies the information into the way you want, or it predicts the information you want. So your model would have never seen a new data that is not there. Now you say that is not part of my population. Your population has basically expanded. You had only access to so much data through which you created your model, but you're getting a completely new data. So your population is expanding.
Ram Chaitanya here.
Yes, Chaitanya.
Yeah, just I'm correlating to my field, like vehicle volumes.
Yep.
Like for example, just to take one example here for EV volumes, predicting the EV volumes.
Okay. Sorry, what is it? I'm sorry.
Electric vehicle volumes.
Okay, electric vehicle volumes. Agreed.
Yeah.
Okay.
So for developing this, it requires 2 years, 3 years development time and all this to develop the complete vehicle.
Right.
To be predicted 2 years or 3 years before.
So you can.
Help to make a decision making, investments and lot of things are there.
Absolutely. That is one of the fantastic ideas to start looking at. So, in the interest of time, maybe I think we could spend just a couple of minutes on that idea, or just 1 minute on that idea to look at. So if you have to look at electric vehicles being launched into the market and you are trying to look at what is my future projections for that particular one, what are my sales would be next year? Let's say already your product is there, what would be my sales? Or if I'm launching the product right now, I don't have any sales, how much sales I can expect? So to understand that, you need to look at different parameters. What are there? Are electric vehicles already there in the market in India? Yes or no? If yes, what are vehicles are there? What are the sales for it? What is the likelihood for people to choose that market, those products over the regular traditional vehicles that are there? So is the market growing? You get data in certain format that you can use that for your modeling purpose. Okay. Then you make all those variables as your independent variables so that based on that, you can predict your projections for your possible sales when you launch your product. So now coming to central limit theorem. So this is exactly what I've been talking about, and the central limit theorem, the very fundamental statement says that if you could connect the things, sampling distribution of the mean of any independent random variable will be normal. Independent random variable could be any metric that we calculated, flavor of a fruit juice or likability of a new phone launched into the market, or likability of a software product that is launched into the market. You can talk about anything, or usability of the software product. You can take anything. It's an independent random variable. Why we call it an independent random variable? Everyone, everywhere, there are no restrictions on that one. Everyone has an opportunity to rate that product equally or provide opinion on that product equally, and the values are random. We understood random, what random means last time. there is an equally likely opportunity for everyone in your population to respond onto that particular one. That's what a random means. You throw a dice from 1 to 6, there is an equal opportunity to come up for any value on that one. You launch a product for a certain population, anyone in your population has opportunity equally to give their opinion on that product. That's what a random variable means. So that distribution of the mean of that sampling distribution will be normal. And as I said, whether your sampling distribution is normal or not, we don't know. But the distribution of the mean definitely will be normal. That's what central limit theorem says. And this applies to both discrete and continuous distributions. You know what is discrete, what is continuous, right? So the random variable should have a well-defined mean and variance. Variance essentially means standard deviation. So square root of variance is nothing but standard deviation. That's why we call well-defined mean and variance. That's the matrix that we capture. It's self-explanatory. Then applicable even when the original variable is not normally distributed. Is it the point that we covered already? So even if the original variable is not normally distributed, the mean of distribution of the means of that population will be normally distributed. So let's look at this central limit theorem. So are you able to see the Python file? Actually, this is a HTML file. I have this in Python also, which I ran, tested everything. So, but I'll use the Python file. Just that is there. That is given, this one. Both are exactly the same. So basically what we are trying to do is importing pandas, simple straight away. Then there is a file called insurance data file. You'll get access to these files once the session gets over. Then another file called Boston. It's a city prices and everything, taxes, different features. Then there is another file called Titanic. Each of these files have one variable, each variable or multiple variables. I didn't even check the files, but there is a variable called charges in insurance, and there is a variable called tax in Boston, and there is a variable called fare in Titanic. We are interested in only these specific variables in each of those data sets. We could have taken any data, so we randomly picked three files and created three series for each of these things. From insurance, the charges is being converted into a series data. From Boston, taxes is taken and another series is created. From Titanic, fare is taken and a series is created. Are we clear till this point? So now we created three different series. These are completely three different variables we created, three series at the end of the day. And now we are creating a function called central limit theorem. This is a user-defined function. All this while, when you use any of these functions like title, xlabel, or data frame, these are all the functions that we use. These are the system functions. These are called system libraries. The libraries that got created come with the pandas libraries and everyone. But this function is a user-defined function. We are defining a function to demonstrate central limit theorem. And what does this function takes? You understand the concept of functions, all of you? Python? Yeah. Basic Python, right?
Yes.
Good. So yes. Now this function, the syntax is essentially you define def in the beginning, define, and then it becomes a function. And all the things follow syntactically like this. And the function name is central limit theorem. So what are the arguments it takes? It takes a data, which essentially is a series. Data is equal to one dimensional array or a pd dot series. So that's why we created all the series at the top. Then we are defining n samples. This is the sample size, essentially number of samples to be created from this data set that is there. So we are saying that create 1,000 samples. Then size of the each sample that we are taking is 500. So each sample will have 500 values. The minimum value should be 0. Maximum value should be 1338. This is primarily taking into account all the values in different variables that are there. That's how those values are chosen. So don't pay too much concern about that. Just some values. Based on your business context, you can define those values whichever way you want. That minimum value is the minimum index of the data, maximum index of the data. So it's not the actual value, the index. So many rows. It is limiting with that particular one. Then matplotlib inline, you already know what matplotlib does. Pandas, numpy, matplotlib, plt, so then seaborn as SNS. So those are the libraries we are importing. Then we are writing a looping function. So B, what is this? What are we creating here?
An array.
Is it array? Are we sure?
The list, right? Use this in the list. I remember. After that, I never used it.
There is one more data type. What are the different data types that we see? It's a dictionary.
It's a dictionary, right? List, yes. I remember that. Right.
Right. Your list is a square bracket.
Yeah. Got it. Yeah.
And what is tuple?
Is one record?
No. Tuple is exactly like dictionary list, but there is one fundamental difference between list and tuple. I know you are going back to Python, but just talking through that one. Except for one fundamental difference between tuple and list. I don't know, we touched it already. But
We touched it, tuple, definitely.
Yeah.
I'm not wrong, it's something which cannot be changed, if tuple, right?
Yes. Tuple is immutable. The term that we use technically is called immutable.
Right.
Yeah. List is mutable, means you can add values, delete values, or you can make modifications, replace, do anything. Whereas tuple, once you create it, you use it. Yeah. So there is no way you edit it. You can delete it at maximum, but the whole tuple, but you cannot change the tuple that gets created.
Yeah.
Right? And what is the importance of dictionary here? Why you are creating a dictionary? Why we are creating, we'll look at that. But what does the dictionary has?
It's very similar to a dictionary, right? A word and a meaning. So it's a...
Yes. So basically in technical parlance, we call it as a key value pair. You will have a key have a value associated with that particular one. Because you need to understand this part. Once you understand this, the rest of the syntax makes easy. That's why I'm trying to put some effort to make that clear, essentially. Right? So now we created an empty dictionary right now. So what we are doing is, for I in range of n samples, what does range of n samples give? The default n samples value, how much we took here? 1,000.
Thousand.
When you actually invoke this function, you can pass any value. That's a different problem. Whatever the value that comes to it, if nobody passes a value, why do we declare here like is equal to 1,000? What is the significance of this? If the user doesn't pass a value for n samples, it by default takes 1,000.
Okay.
That's why we initial declaration. This is a default declaration value. If user defines a value or passes an argument, it takes that value. If not, it takes 1,000. That's the purpose of giving a value at the frame of defining the function. Okay. So now for example, take 1,000. So for I in range of 1,000, what is range of 1,000 means? The value ranges from, it creates a list. And the list ranges from 0 to
1,000.
$9.99. Exactly. Thanks, Bruno. It's 0 to $9.99. It has 1,000 values, but it doesn't take 1,000. So for each of those values, 0 to 999, it starts creating this particular thing. Now let's see what it is doing. Basically, to simply put it, it creates a random numbers of specific size, but it is invoking NumPy array. First, let's come from inside to outside. That makes our life easy. So in NP library, or the NumPy library, we have a module called
random.
What does random do?
Picks up random.
It creates random values of your specific choice. And we are using a function called randint. What does randint does?
Generates random
integers. Random integers, correct. So we define this random integer from a minimum value, there is a maximum value, and create these many values, the size. If I say, let's say for example, randint of 0, 10, 5, it creates 5 values between 0 and 10. That's what randint does. This whole thing creates a list of 5 values with value between 0 and 1. So here it creates a list of this size, sample size, whose values range between minimum value and maximum value. This minimum value, maximum value are nothing but what you passed here. And the size is nothing but the sample size you passed here. Getting this? Yeah. That's what randint does. But when you do this, because it is a random integer, you create, let's say, 100 values between 0 and 1,000. There is a very likelihood that it will create duplicate values, right? Because it is a random number. It can throw the same number again. And in the list, we don't want the duplication. We want to eliminate all duplicates and have only the unique values. That's why this np.unique function is used. So now this np.unique eliminates all the duplicate values from that list that got created by randint, this thing, and those unique values as a list is assigned to x.
X may be 500, may not be 500 in that case, right?
Yes, exactly. You're absolutely right. The maximum value it can take is 500 in this scenario. We are calculating. So this, what is this x now? X is a list, but what does x have? What did we say these values? Is the index. So we are saying b we created as a dictionary, B of I is equal to data of X. What is this data? Nothing but the series that we are passing here.
Okay.
Right? For that series, for these many values, let's say, for example, the series that I am passing, for example, is series 1. So let's go down and we'll see. I'll show you how we invoke that. So I'm invoking central limit theorem, series 3, n samples equal to 5000, sample size equal to 500. When I invoke this particular example, what is this taking? Now my data here is series 3.
Ram, one question. So when you said for I in range above, that means you're actually running in a loop for 1000 times. This X is equal to...
Yes. So I'm creating... So X is one sample. Like that, I'm exactly creating N samples.
Right. And all they will be stored inside X?
All will be stored... No, each X will be one individual sample. Like that, I'll create N sample X. Or means samples. You understand what I'm saying?
It makes a matrix, right?
It makes a matrix, exactly. Okay. So one row would be like this thing. So let me quickly, I don't know if I was testing that particular one. Let me do this quickly for you so that you understand. Because, so the focus here for us is central limit theorem, but we are getting into NumPy and pandas, but no worries. Let me quickly handle this.
Because your objective is, our objective is to create n number of different samples and each sample having some random numbers, right?
Right. So after this, let me create a simple example of this one so that you understand. Is equal to np dot unique of np random randint of 0, as I was talking about. The maximum value is 100. And the size should be, how many values I need? 10 values. Okay. When I do this, so this is a sample. It is not nothing with the actual data. So now test is created. Okay. Now if I say test 1, see, it created values between 0 and 100 and it picked exactly 10 values. Right. Just in case if I didn't have, because it's such a huge range, it might not. So let's say, for example, I take 10. And I take 6 values here, just as a simple. See, 8 repeated. So that's why we put the NP unique essentially. Once we do this, if I create a dictionary like this, and if I put this creation in a for loop, it is going to create this test variable n number of times. If I say use for loop for 10 times, it creates 10 times. If I create 100 times, it creates 100. In the central limit theorem function that I called, I created n samples equal to 5000. So whenever I call this function now, when I use the 5000 here, the default value was 1000 in this function, n samples. But now I am passing 5000 as an argument. So this for loop will get executed. This is the for loop, essentially. This for loop gets executed how many times? 5000 times. So there are 5000 samples like this get created. So 5000 arrays gets created like this.
How they will be identified, Ram, all these arrays? I mean, will be stored in within X only, right?
That's why the next step is important for us.
Okay.
So once you create X, we don't need all the data. This is all dummy data that we are creating. So I don't need the data. What I need is a mean value for that sample. So.
And he's putting into that dictionary, BI. Getting implemented, right?
Right. But the more important part you need to know about is through this random in that I'm calculating at the end of the day is just the index that I'm getting. It's not the actual data. My actual data sits in data. This is all samples only, the index. You're getting?
Yeah. We're getting that one. X is just an indicator.
X is the index. Now, yeah, what index I do is getting. When I say data of X, let's say, for example, test 2 is right. Now, if I say series 1 of test 2. Let's see what this gives. See, the series 1, now test 2 could have been 970369 is the values identified. Now I pass this array as an argument to series 1. It is pulling the corresponding values of this particular one. So if I take series 1, did I do something? See, what is the series 1? 0, 16884. Series 1, 0, 16884. So the 0th value in series 1, it is picking. So the what we are creating through this exercise is the index that is being used. And that index for the array that I create,
and then getting the mean, right?
Mean of the data points,
I didn't create that particular
index.
X is index and bi is the mean of the that index. Getting.
So now,
basically
now
we are creating the dictionary.
Exactly. So I is the key for the dictionary, and the mean is the value for that index.
Got it. Okay.
That's the key. Yeah. Key value pair we are creating. So now I create this. After this particular one, this whole thing gets stored in B.
Okay. Okay.
Now
so I'm. X is getting repeated.
Sorry?
X is actually calculating, I mean, generating the random number, storing in array, then BI is calculating the mean of X and storing into the dictionary.
Yes, exactly, exactly.
X is like a temporary variable.
Exactly, yeah, yeah. Now,
is it making sense?
I know.
No, because what we are trying to do is we are using and creating a random index, and then through random index, we are capturing the data from the series that is passed, and for that data we are calculating the mean, and for that index the mean is assigned as a value. So the index is the key, that I is the key, and the mean is the value for that one. So we are creating a key value pair structure in this dictionary.
Yeah, got it.
And now I create a pandas data frame using this dictionary. It's easy to create a pandas data frame through dictionary because you have a key, you have a value. Key is nothing but your label, and value is nothing but the content in that particular variable. So C, I'm creating C is equal to pandas data frame. Now C of sample is equal to B of keys. What is it? B of keys essentially? All the I values that got stored.
Right. All index actually, right.
Yeah. Now C is the mean. All values of this particular one, the means that we calculated are going into data frame. So data frame has two columns now. One is the sample, the other one is the mean. So first sample, what is the mean? Second sample, what is the mean? Third sample, what is the mean? It just calculates that, creates that pandas data frame. Are we good with this thing? So this is randomly how we created data for our statistics testing purposes. So the rest is pretty straightforward essentially. So once you create that, now you're creating this charts, this figure, you create this particular one. Then I am creating two charts. One chart is for sampling distribution. The other chart is for the population distribution. For me, the sample distribution essentially is nothing but all the samples that I got, the distribution of these samples and its means. And for population, for the whole population, I take the data itself, the data that I pass as an argument, which is the whole series. Those metrics are being taken here.
That's where it is getting stored inside the data RAM.
So data is an argument that is being passed. So the same data we are using here.
Okay.
So now this is all about, if I go back to the PPT that we have, it is proving this line. This is what central limit theorem critically important for us. Sampling distribution of the mean of any independent random variable will be normal, though the original variable is not normally distributed. Just to prove this, we are doing this exercise. So this is the sampling distribution of the means that we calculated. The first one is about the means we are doing, right? The mean value. So the mean is normally distributed. This is how a normal distribution looks like. Whereas your population distribution is actually not normal. So is it which side skew? Left skew, right skew?
Right skew.
Right skewed.
Right skewed, exactly. And now if you look at another example, so we took three examples, right? Three data sets. Again, the mean is normally distributed and your population is bimodal, essentially. And you take this one. This is very, very right skewed distribution, very thin distribution happening. Despite all that, you see your mean distribution is normally distributed. Is this making sense, folks? What central limit theorem actually means? This is a demonstration of central limit theorem primarily.
I think because with this example at our hand, I think it's very, very clear actually. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's primarily is the central limit theorem first. I would suggest go back, watch the video again, practice this file, change your own values. Like I created this test values, how the NP random works and everything. Here also make your own changes, start looking at the thing. Then you will start absorbing what actually this code is all about, what it is telling. And then read a little bit about central limit theorem. You'll understand the things far, far better. So that's primarily about sampling distributions and central limit theorem. Now, why central limit theorem is so important for us? Because most of the times we operate with the sample statistics and population parameters. And as we said, the sampling distribution of the statistic generally tends to be normal, subject to the condition of your have a decent sufficient sample size. It tends to become a normal. If the sample size is not sufficient enough, then this might not hold true. We'll see the scenarios of that one, but otherwise it tends to be normal. Once it becomes normal, you have to understand how your data distribution is looking like. Once you get a hold of your distribution, then you start identifying or validating your hypothesis. You build your hypothesis on that particular one, and then you validate your hypothesis and do inferential statistics or analytics around that one, which is basically your hypothesis.
I mean, we are trying to standardize a non-standardized population, and then
We are not trying to. By default, the statistic tends to be normally distributed. That's why the normal distribution forms this core of this whole statistics that we do.
Right, right. Exactly. Yeah. I mean, yeah? Otherwise, you don't have a handle to even infer the
population. Deal with. No. Hold on your thought onto that particular one. But I'm just giving a teaser here. When we talk of mean, it is normally distributed. But when you talk of variance, it is not normally distributed. If you have followed the videos completely, you know what I'm referring to. What distribution will come with the variance?
Chi-square.
It's called chi-square distribution. Good, Prasad. So it's called chi-square distribution. So if variance follows chi-square distribution. Chi-square, variance does not follow normal distribution. We'll see why and how when we get there. Okay, let's move on to hypothesis testing. Okay, before actually doing a hypothesis test, first let's understand what hypothesis is all about. So what does hypothesis means?
An assumption or a thought which is not validated yet.
Okay, anything else?
Just a theory.
Based on the limited data or limited samples.
Limited samples, limited data, not validated, yes. But it's fundamentally an intuition that you have. At the core of it, it's an intuition for you. You may be backed up by data, as somebody said, we have limited data, we have data, then it's just an observation, just your intuition, something. At the end of the day, for me, hypothesis is an intuition that is there, which is not proven. The moment it is proven, it is no more hypothesis. The underlying key point for a hypothesis is which is not yet proven. Yeah. So that's what hypothesis, which is not yet proven, an intuition, observation based on data, may not be based on data. That is something. So that needs to be either proved or rejected. There are only two possibilities to that particular one. Either you reject it or you do not reject it. There is no question of approving it. The accepting it. In hypothesis, the important point of hypothesis tests or whatever it is, there is no way you can say it is accepted. You can reject it with conclusive evidence, or you cannot reject it. But there is no way that I can prove that one. There's no conclusive way to approve that particular one. That's the important element of hypothesis. So what is null hypothesis? Then we have two types of hypothesis. One is, we'll talk with examples, then we'll understand. So what is null hypothesis? Hypothesis that does not challenge the status quo. Alternative hypothesis that challenge the status quo. So before we go on to what all different scenarios that are possible, let's take from real life examples. What is all possible? The hypothesis. I think in the very first session, we talked about somebody getting temperature. You go to the doctor. You are getting temperature for the last 7 days continuously in the range of 100, 102, 100, 102. You are using medicines and everything. It is not coming down. Then you go to the doctor. Doctor has a... What will doctor have?
Yes, hypothesis that it could be malaria.
Hypothesis that it could be a malaria. So now he asked you to conduct a blood test. You go for the blood test. Now blood test results come. Based on the blood test results, what can doctor do?
He can reject the hypothesis.
He can reject the hypothesis that it is not malaria. But can he accept that it is malaria by that one? Maybe yes, maybe not. Because there are other scenarios also possible which could be leading to that particular one. But there could be certain conditions which categorically tell you that this is not malaria. You say that it is just viral, but something or some other infection is there. It's not malaria. So that's what your hypothesis. Then you do exercise. Then you validate it through certain things. So in a simple scenario, we generally tend to conform with what is normally observed, which is not deviant from the regular observable phenomena. That's what we call as a null hypothesis. The other example the class talked about in the videos essentially is the Coca-Cola bottle. In a Coca-Cola bottle, you have 500 ml, 600 ml. The hypothesis is that by default, you always have 600 ml. Otherwise, in reality, if that is not the scenario, we don't trust what is mentioned there. Every day we'll be doing a testing exercise. So we trust that particular one. So what is the reason or belief behind that trusting? Now I'm getting to a little generic discussion into this. Why do we trust that if the bottle on the Coca-Cola mentions as it's 500 ml and we go with 500 ml as an accepted state, we never go and measure whether it is actually 500 ml or not?
We believe it has been tested many times.
Right.
Who has tested it?
The company, and we believe it.
If company does it, you don't believe. Company can claim anything.
So mention on the bottle.
No, yeah, I can mention anything.
Government authorities, or someone is randomly testing it.
There is the thing called as ISI, Indian Statistical Institute, which actually gives the measurement approval. There is all those things that are tested by anything that today you produce 1,000 bottles and give it to me. I'll verify all the samples. Give me 10 lots, 100 lots of 1,000 samples each. Then I verify all of them. We measure where the range is coming, whether all the bottles contain an acceptable range of 500 ml or not. 5 ml less, 5 ml more. It is a very hot season. Given that Coca-Cola is nothing but water, there's a possibility that in a heavy summer, the water likely to get a little this thing. So the quantity might get reduced a little bit. So I may not have exactly 500 ml. I can have 495 ml or 490 ml. Is it acceptable? Maybe yes. Owing to those conditions, I am okay giving that consideration to the company. But instead of 500 ml, let's say the bottle has only 425 ml. Should I believe that but the temperature or these things scenarios are causing all this extra heavy, extra heat and everything causing that? 75 ml, unlikely scenario. There is some goof up going. So as a customer, if I start observing that, it is not 500 ml, it is less, then I start making a hypothesis. What will be my hypothesis? The bottle does not contain 500 ml as it is mentioned, but it is going against the norm. What is the norm here?
500 ml.
Bottle contains 500 ml is the norm. So which is the accepted norm generally is called as your null hypothesis. What is that you are proposing contrary to the accepted norm is your alternative hypothesis. It challenges the status quo. You understand the concepts here, how these two work? This is very important. And the discussion that we had earlier, what is my population? It is ever changing. Like that, there is an element of subjectivity which is pertaining to or which is very much owned by the business person, the person who is in charge of this thing, who is the owner of the question. Here in this scenario, what is null hypothesis? My null hypothesis need not be your null hypothesis. I think the example in the class again talked about, if I frame that question from a customer standpoint, it could be a different question. If I frame that question from a company standpoint, it could be a different hypothesis. You're getting the perspectives? So the perspectives at times, who is the point, who is driving it, might also make a difference between what is the accepted norms. In general scenarios, there should be an agreement everywhere. What is the accepted norm? You go with that. But those hypotheses, the way you consider them, might be different from business to business.
Now, it is updated in the materials. It is like a quality control there is used. So there, basically, it is a company standpoint of view?
Whether it is a company standpoint of view, customer standard point of view in this scenario, what is the observed norm? Essentially, the bottle should contain 500 ml. There is no deviation to that one. All right. The company claims that most of the times it is either 600 or more, and it should not be less. The customer says that it is less than 500 ml, less than 500 ml clearly.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Both are talking about being 500 ml is the core point. That's the accepted null hypothesis for both the parties in that scenario.
All the difference could be for the company, if it is significantly higher than 600, actually they are
losing. It's a loss for the company.
But for a customer, it's okay. All he's interested is it should be more than
600. More I am not bothered. I'll be happy. But if I get less. And imagine Coca-Cola, I don't bother. You are buying gold. Imagine what happens. Every gram starts varying by 1,000 rupees, 2,000 rupees, right? So that will have a bearing on the things. So let's take another. Can you people come up with one example quickly? What can be in any example that we see in real life?
I think the quote example.
Quote is one again touched in the classroom. I'll take it. But anything that you come from your side? See, think from your own business scenarios. This is where you start applying your learnings to your world, your environments.
In my case, you know, when our finance guys do the
Prasad,
customer sorry. Always pay on the due date. My voice not clear?
I think some break is happening. I don't know if it's only with me or everyone is feeling the same. But
is it okay now?
Now it is okay.
Okay. So in my situation, so we have a finance collections team and the hypothesis is customer always pays on the due date because we have a due date and customer should pay on that. So null hypothesis is customer pay on the due date. But I have a feeling that no, he's not. I mean, he's
brilliant example. Brilliant example. So your null hypothesis essentially is all customers pay money on due date. Alternative hypothesis could be not all customers pay contrary to that one essentially. So a better way of putting is at least 90% of my customers pay dues on date.
Okay. Yeah.
The alternative hypothesis could be more than 10% of customers pay dues after the deadline.
Right. Right. Yeah.
That's how you construct. Is everyone clear with this one? No problem. We'll move on. So now, but what this leads to is there is a reality, truth. The actual truth, then you are doing a test on that particular one. We'll see what test, how do you do the test and everything that comes later. But the result of your test, the inferential statistics part, the result of your test, you say that whether that hypothesis that you had, null hypothesis, can be rejected or cannot be rejected. Two scenarios that we talked about, right? This is the null hypothesis. It should not be rejected. Or null hypothesis is false, so it should be rejected. This is the true scenarios, actual scenarios. So this is your decision, what you are making based on your inferential statistics. You observed something in the samples. Based on that, you take this call. So now the clear scenarios is when null hypothesis should not be rejected and you don't reject it, it's a correct decision. There is no problem at all. This is a good scenario to have. Similarly, when you should reject it and you are rejecting it, this is a good scenario again. So this bucket and this bucket are exactly good scenarios. Now you go back to your scenario, Prasad, that you talked about people paying all their bills on due date, essentially by due date. 90% of the customers go by due date. And you actually take a sample. Let's say your population is 10 lakh customers. You can't check for all 10 lakhs. So you randomly pick a sample out of your 10 lakhs customers that you have, take a 20,000 sample and you do that. You realize that 88% of the people have paid on time. So is 88% within the acceptable range of the 90% hypothesis that you have, or the 2% is a big variation that you cannot accept and now your hypothesis is wrong. You should reject it. Looks like everyone is sleeping afternoon time.
No, Ram, you're following. Yeah.
Nah, I'm hearing absolute silence. So.
There are a little bit philosophical topics, right? So, yeah, but we are following.
We went through this video.
Good. So,
fine, Raman, I see if I cannot connect it to that. See, if, for example, if my hypothesis is true that customers are paying on time, and if I reject it, that yeah. I believe that customers are not paying on time, there is a financial impact. And actually, I'm going and arranging my fund.
You're actually hitting into the business impact of why hypothesis testing is such an important thing for us to do, essentially. So as long as you are fine with whatever the results your test is saying and what the reality is, you don't have a problem. But now imagine a scenario where your hypothesis is essentially 90% of the people and 88%, 89% of the people are paying on time, then you say that your test said that no, that 88, 89% is not within the acceptable range of 90%. We get into standard deviations and variations, everything coming into play and how that plays a role. For whatever reasons, you say that that is not an acceptable range, so I reject that. Because of which what you do, earlier you would have given a grace time of 25 days from the due date to pay either ways, essentially. Now you reduce that to 10 days, which essentially is going to cause a heartburn, concerns, challenges to your customers and say that I move from you to some other provider. I don't look at you. I'll go to somebody else. Which means it is a loss of business for you in that case. On the contrary, let's say for example, instead of 88, 89, you have around 82, 83% people say. And still you live with it, saying that, okay, this is fine with me. That's a wrong, actually. But your test says that you can't reject it. So you accept and you live with that, okay, 84% or 83% essentially is within the acceptable range of 90%. Good to be there. Nothing to be done. Essentially what this does, you are getting a revenue loss. You are not getting your revenues on time, which creates challenges for your business, day-to-day operations, everything. So you don't get money on hand on time. So it creates other kinds of problems for you.
Yeah, I'm back. I'm sorry for that. I had a power shutdown, sir. Sorry.
No problem. So I was talking about your example, essentially talking about two scenarios. If you say that even with a minor variation, it is in the acceptable range, but you reject that particular decision that your customers are not paying on time and you make amendments to the acceptable things. Essentially what I'm trying to tell you, Prasad, I'm not sure you heard it clearly. Your problem of people paying on time.
Right.
Right. 90% is the acceptable normal range. That's what your average says primarily. But
right.
But you say that 88% or 87% are paying on time. That's what your test says. And right. You say that 87% is not acceptable. So
right.
You reject. Because of which you take a decision that I will reduce the terms and conditions from 20 days of grace period to 10 days of grace period.
Right. Exactly.
So now what does that lead to? It creates concerns, unhappiness, disappointment with people, and your customers will migrate to some other provider.
Exactly.
Right? So which is a loss for your business. On the other hand, you say that let's say people 84% or 83% of the people are paying on time. But you say that is acceptable range of 90%, which is not in reality. So then you end up getting money much later than what you anticipate or this thing, which causes concerns for your day-to-day management or your money revenue operation essentially. So you don't want either of the scenarios. You want to give your leeway to the customers, be in the acceptable range. At the same time, you want to get money on time. So this is the balancing act that you do between type 1 error and type 2 error.
Right. Got it, Ron. Yep. And both have different consequences, right? I mean, if you commit a type 2 error, we will have a financial issue. We are not able to manage the fund.
Exactly.
If one error, we'll have unhappy customers.
Yes. So there is no scenario where you have type 1 error completely eliminated, type 2 error completely eliminated. The balance between these two is such that you try to reduce type 1 error by increasing your confidence level to an extent, you are creating type 2 error more. Or you try and manage type 2 error in one way, type 1 error increases. So it's a balance that you need to strike appropriately. That's where your hypothesis testing would come into play. And business knowledge will come into play. Where should I draw the line? That's why for somebody else, I'm okay with 90% confidence level. Somebody says I'm okay with 95% confidence level. Somebody says 99% confidence level. And if I had to take one step that is nowhere mentioned in the video, but I connect the dots, the very concept of origination of Six Sigma comes from this one.
Yeah, correct. Three sigmas, right? Three, both sides. Yeah.
It's a Six Sigma. So you reduce the standard deviation as much as possible, and still you ensure that most of your data points actually lie between six standard deviations from your mean. It's not one, two, three standard deviations, but six standard deviations. That's why we strive for Six Sigma. Imagine a simple example where in reality, in a flight, in an airlines industry, should they be operating at 6 sigma, 4 sigma, 5 sigma, 2 standard deviations? Where should they operate? even one flight in terms of the amount of losses it causes to lives, money, investments, exercises, the subsequent investigations that go, the amount of challenges it is going to create is phenomenal. So you cannot live with that. So you are okay the flight being delayed than flight ending up with an issue. So this is where a type 1 error, type 2 error is important. Let's say new medicine, new drug is getting created. When they do the medical test, they need to be absolutely sure that it does not have any unintended side effects. So what is the accuracy level they should look at? 1 sigma, 2 sigma, 3 sigma?
Maybe more than 6 sigma.
It should be, because one wrong consequence on testing kind of a thing could lead to any undesirable consequences for the company when it goes into production. So if type 2 error goes there, okay, my medicine is good and everything, and once it launched into the market, they will have undesirable consequences like the Merck. Merck has produced, if I remember correctly, long back some medicine for arthritis. It reduces your knee pain significantly. People are really, really happy with the knee pain. But what they didn't realize is it actually weakening your heart significantly. This is a long back story, very old story. But because of that one, Merck has ended up paying billions and billions as a compensation to its customers. So these scenarios play a significant role in real time. I know you're spending a good amount of time here, but you need to understand these pieces. Now let's move on.
Ram, sorry to hold you up.
Yes,
one fundamental question. So this null hypothesis and alternative talks about your population parameter. The underlying assumption is if my sample is normally distributed, my population is also normally distributed. Is that right, or it may not be?
May not be. If your population is normally distributed, any sample size picked from a normally distributed population can be normal. But the converse is not true. Means if a sample is normally distributed, there is no guarantee that your population needs to be normally distributed. That's what the central limit theorem that we have seen talked about, right?
Right. So in that case, if I'm making my inference about the population based out of my observation on the sample, when they are not normally distributed, how this inference is true, or I'm probably missing a point here, but this is my gap in my
understanding. I get it. I think the same question which Prasad raised earlier. So sometimes you don't have knowledge of population. So how do I go about making an assumption about my this thing? So that's why you start tweaking your sample size to a significant extent. So basically, if you ignore a particular industry, ignore a particular business, particular type of a problem you are solving, as an accepted norm in statistics, your sample size goes bigger and bigger and bigger, you generally tend to represent a normal distribution of your population, which is applicable to the population. And the statistics that you pick up for your sample tend to closely represent, the closely is a very relative and ambiguous word, but tend to closely represent your population.
Okay.
Does that answer your question, Ram Chandam?
Yeah, sure, thanks.
Good. See, because most of the problems that you see, you'll never have a handle on your population in realistic scenarios. That's why the element of extrapolation through inferential statistics comes into play. Moving on. So now, what types of hypothesis tests that we do? Now, there are three different parameters that we do. We consider when you're doing a hypothesis test. It could be based on sample, or it could be based on type of the hypothesis that you are making, or it could be based on the type of statistic that you are using for making your hypothesis. If you're talking of one sample, so take the fruit juice. The one rating that I'm going to capture is, I like this fruit juice. Simple question on a scale of 1 to 10. One, I don't like at all. 10, I like it fully. On that scale, you capture the rating, one metric, one sample. So you capture the sample on that one, you get a statistic. That's one sample test. Now, you measure that fruit juice rating in two different places, compare one against the other, it's two samples. Is it clear what we are talking about? And then you do the same exercise with four cities, it becomes multiple samples. Now, there is an interesting dimension that we can get it with the samples itself. Right now, the fruit juice is already there in the market. I get ratings of likability of the fruit juice currently. Then next month, I'll start making tweaks to the, my fruit juice composition. Then I launch the product back to the same set of people who have rated me earlier. So it's the same population. There is an earlier rating, then there is a later rating. Two ratings coming into play. Then my hypothesis would be more like, is a fruit juice liked more significantly compared to the earlier version, or it is less likely? Which is the hypothesis? That's the other way to look at it. So one is a paired test, one is an independent sample test. So those are all different scenarios possible from a sample perspective. Is clear with the samples? We'll take examples on that one. But is the concept of the sample, how it plays a role in hypothesis test, clear? Guys, I would feel a nod would be a sound would be a bit better option. Yes. I know.
Yes, Ram. Yeah.
Sure. Thank you. The next one is one-tailed versus two-tailed. What is this concept of tailed?
This is the, precisely the Coca-Cola example you said, right? I mean, if
a yes.
customer he is interested in, if it is minimum 600 ml, and for the company, it is more important if it is both sides, right? Greater or lesser. So
greater or lesser
is two-tailed, yes.
An easier way to remember this particular one is the sign of equality, where the sign of equality comes in. If your null hypothesis has an equal sign in it,
that's two-tailed, right?
That's two-tailed.
Yeah.
Because the alternative can go in either direction. The bottle contains exactly 600 ml is my hypothesis. So volume is equal to 600 ml is the hypothesis. Alternative hypothesis could be volume not equal to 600. It can be less, it can be more. So that's two tails. I'm going on either side of my mean, essentially. That's why it's a two-tail test. And instead of that, if my hypothesis essentially becomes volume, the bottle contains more than 600 ml, it becomes a one-tail test. So my base itself starts at 600. So there is no way for me to do anything for less than 600. I start at 600 and go above that particular one.
Right. Yeah.
That's one-tail. The simplest way to remember. So if you're have null hypothesis has an equality into that particular one baked in, it's a two-tailed test. If it is not there, it's a one-tailed test. That's the second way of hypothesis testing. The third one essentially is test of means. So different statistics. For a given population, you can say, what is my average likability rating? The same fruit juice example. Or I can talk about how many people have rated more than 8, which is 9 and 10. How many people have rated 9 and 10? Top two box, simply called in market research parlance. Or what is the variance? If variance can be looked at primarily when you're looking at multiple samples. What is the variance between the two samples? Is the variance significantly higher, significantly lower? There is not much of a distinction between the two samples that I'm looking at. That's where you depend on the statistics or the metrics that you are using. So based on these three, so there can be done independently, a combination of these things can be done. So there are different types of hypothesis tests possible. One dimension that is not mentioned here, nor in the videos to an extent, I think videos somewhere it is captured, but one thing to keep in mind is depending on the data also what you are doing. So there is a parametric data, or the scale data, what we call as. The other one is a categorical data. I think we covered this categorical data element in the last session. How a categorical data would look like nominal data, ordinal data, interval data, ratio. You remember?
Yeah, we remember the words, but maybe the meanings we need to refer once again.
So as we go forward, it's wise not to forget the old sessions.
Female.
See, okay, let's do a quick refresh. A nominal data is primarily an identification purpose.
Right, okay.
An ordinal data is where you have a rank ordering possible, but there is no quantification of the variation between two levels. You say good, bad, ugly. Good is better than bad, but how much better we don't know.
Okay.
And bad is better than ugly, but how much better we don't know. And is the difference between good and bad exactly same as bad and ugly? We don't know. But we definitely know that good is better than bad and bad is better than ugly. That's one kind of a scaling. It's called as an ordinal data, where you know the rank ordering, but you don't know the extent and the quantification of it. The third data is interval data.
That's like class intervals, right? Basically, yeah.
class intervals in a way. A better example normally we take in all scenarios essentially possible is temperature.
Temperature, yeah, right.
So, but simple way to remember an interval data is on that data you can perform addition and subtraction, but you cannot do multiplication and division.
Yeah, makes sense.
So if one place is 55 degrees centigrade, other place is 70 degrees centigrade, you can say that that place is 15 degrees more hotter than this place. But if one place is 35 degrees centigrade, other is 70 degrees centigrade, can you say it is double? No.
Right.
That's what your interval scale data is. And the example time and again I quoted in this session, a rating of likability for a fruit juice, scale of 1 to 10. What scale it would be? What data it would be?
That's interval data, right?
Interval data.
Yeah.
Because you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You have 1 to 2 an interval, 2 to 3 another interval, 3 to 4 another interval. Those are interval data, clearly. But if somebody has rated 8 and somebody has rated 4, can I say that the one who rated 8 is 2 times the one who has rated 4 in his likability towards the product?
No.
Cannot. So you cannot do that. So basically what we do is all these rating scales, this is just a sidebar information for you to keep in mind, because at any point of time in your firms, you're working with market research data, you'll see these rating questions more often than not. So rating scales are called as AID scales, assumed interval difference scales or equal interval difference scales. So the hypothesis that goes is the difference between 2 and 1 is exactly same as the difference between 3 and 2. And the difference between 4 and 5 is same as difference between 9 and 10. So that's why they're equally spaced scales, the intervals. When that criteria comes into play, the one who rated 8 is definitely 2 times the one who has rated 4 in terms of the likability. That hypothesis helps in calculating the converting the interval data into the next top of the data that we are talking, which is the ratio scale. In a ratio level data, you can do all four operations, addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division. So there is an absolute zero, height, weight, money. These are all examples of ratio scale data. So 1 rupee is half of 2 rupees. 10 rupees is double of 5 rupees because there is an absolute zero reference point. In interval data, you don't have an absolute zero. Because my zero reference point is not same as yours when I rate on a particular attribute. So those are the types of data. Based on that type of data, if your data is basically ordinal, the type of which essentially means categorical, or to an extent interval, the tests that you do, hypothesis tests that you do, are slightly different. Whereas if your scale data is, if your data is ratio scale data, the type of the test that you do is slightly different. That's where the classification comes as parametric tests and non-parametric tests. Is that concept clear of parametric and non-parametric?
Can you repeat that once again, Ram, the parametric, non-parametric?
Sure. Now we know there are four types of data, nominal, ordinal, interval, and ratio.
Right.
Good. So nominal data, you won't do any operations on that particular one, basically.
Correct. Yeah.
Then you have ordinal and interval data. To an extent, they are called as a categorical data.
Right. Okay. Yeah.
So your interval data can be classified sometimes as categorical, sometimes as non-categorical, sometimes as ratio, based on how you make the assumptions. But think the data as two types: categorical data, numerical data, quantitative data.
Right.
Based on these two types, the hypothesis tests that you do are different for categorical data and are different for parametric data.
Okay, so the non-categorical data or numerical data is parametric data, right?
Yes. One is parametric, one is non-parametric. For all categorical data, you do a non-parametric tests.
Right.
For all parametric data, you do a parametric tests. Good. I think I should get that chart. Based on what type of data, what tests you do. There is like toxins, Mann-Whitney, then paired samples, normal, when the data is normal, when the data is not normal, when the data is parametric, when the data is not parametric, when it is one sample, when it is two samples. There are different, there is a table that is out there, a visual. Let me find and share that with you. I'll share that on the WhatsApp for all of you so that it becomes easy for you to do that.
Such a table is there, that would be great actually.
Yeah. Sorry, Chaitanya.
Yeah, it's really helpful.
Yeah, yeah. Let me find and send that. I think I should have that. Let me find and share that again. Yeah? Good. We'll move on. So when we come to hypothesis tests and you start making inferences, there are two concepts that we need to be clear of. One is confidence level. Second one is confidence interval. Okay. Confidence level is about how certain are you about the assumption that you are making. Let's say, for example, I throw a die. What is the standard assumption that we have? Sorry, let's say take a simple example. Let me throw a coin which has heads and tails. What is the assumption? The probability of heads is equal to probability of tails. That's, and what is the confidence level that I should go with for that one?
50-50.
Confidence level that you will get equal number of heads when you toss a coin n number of times, the number of times the head comes is exactly equal to the number of times the tail comes. What is the confidence level I am asking? Not number of times it will come. Percentage. 100% is your confidence level, right?
Yeah, yeah.
But when I throw a coin 100 times, are you sure exactly I get 50-50?
So then
where is your confidence level of 100% going for? You believe that it has to be 100%, right? But you don't expect it to be 50-50 exactly when you throw it 100 times.
Right.
So where is this whole thing going?
You need to set a threshold and then believe it if it is below that.
Exactly. So that's where your normal distribution concept essentially comes into play. The number of trials that you are conducting becomes larger and larger. The deviation between number of heads and number of tails that is appearing will become less and less over with the number of trials increasing. That's exactly what central limit theorem says. As the sample approaches the population, the mean is representative, mean of the sample is representative of the population. In reality, it has to be exactly equal. There is no denial about it. But when you do it, where are you drawing the line? If I throw only 5 times, it could be 3-2. There is no way I get 2.5, 2.5. If I throw it 10 times, it can be 6-4, or it can be 5-5, or it can be sometimes 7-3. But if I throw 100 times, the variations, the proportion of variation between the two results becomes smaller and smaller. And if it goes 1,000 times, 10,000 times, it becomes even lesser. And that increases your confidence level. So your confidence level primarily talks about, if I conduct an experiment n number of times, at least 95% of the times, or at least this confidence level, whatever I decide, that percentage of the times, my result will be in the expected range. That's the confidence I take. If you go to the doctor prescribes you a paracetamol for temperature, basic temperature that he sees, the confidence level he has is 95% of the times, at least the temperature should go down when I give a Calpol or a paracetamol. Essentially, that's why he gives it. If he has only 50% confidence, can he prescribe paracetamol to you? So that's the confidence level essentially means. So if I give to 100 people, 100 patients paracetamol, at least in 90% of the cases, 95% of the cases, the temperature should go down. That's my primary hypothesis. The confidence with which you can say that is called as a confidence level. And interestingly, this confidence level is determined by something called as a level of significance. So what is the acceptable range that you are fine with your experiment failing or not falling in the accepted norms? So if you go back to your type 1, type 2 that we talked about, type 1 error is what we call as alpha. So your null hypothesis should not be rejected, but you reject it. What is the likelihood that you are making a mistake by rejecting it when you should not be? That's what it is. So going to the doctor example, what is the likelihood that temperature will not go down when a paracetamol is prescribed, while it is a norm accepted hypothesis that a paracetamol should reduce your temperature? That's what the level of significance. So 1 minus level of significance tells you your confidence level. So level of significance and confidence level are mutually exclusive. It's 1 minus essentially. The total should be equal to 1 or 100%. Is that concept clear? Good. Now when you see your confidence level is 5%, that leads to what are we talking of? Acceptable range. Now go back to the coin toss example. When I toss a coin 1,000 times, what is number of times I get a head and number of times I should get a tail? The ideal scenario is 500 and 500. Let's take only one result. Both results lead to a little confusing and it's mutually exclusive. So it doesn't make sense. One is converse of the other. So let's take the number of times you get a heads. Your hypothesis says that I should get n equal to 500. If my this thing is n is equal to number of trials is equal to 1,000, number of heads is equal to 500. That's my hypothesis. If I get 470 or 530, I'm taking 30, 30 this side or that side. So the 30 variation from 500 is acceptable or not acceptable? How do I draw the line?
That's based on the threshold you are setting, or the alpha you are setting, right?
That is the confidence level. Now you are understanding where confidence level come into play? An acknowledgement, please. If not, this is an important concept that you should believe in. You should understand.
Yes.
Yes.
Good.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. So
imagine if you set up your confidence level as 100% in your example, that you will reject everything if it is not. You
reject everything, which essentially leads to your type 2 error. Why? So you define boundaries. This is the acceptable range of error that I can live with in this scenario. So if let's say I define 10% of the confidence interval. So on 500 heads should come, what is the 10% that can I can live with? Variations?
50.
So it can range between 450 to 550. So if it is coming between 450 to 550, I'm good with that experiment. Then when I do it, this experiment again, throw the coin 1,000 times, I get 425. Then is it acceptable or not? Should I accept my null hypothesis that it is within the range of 500 or not now? No.
You have the type one
error, essentially, because it is falling out of the range. So this, based on your confidence level that you defined, you are defining a lower bound and upper bound. The lower bound is 450, upper bound is 550. This 450 to 550 interval is called as your confidence interval. Are you connecting the dots between confidence level and confidence interval?
When is the situation or how do we define these intervals, or are they preset intervals?
You don't define intervals. You define confidence level, which leads right to automatic creation of your confidence levels. And what is that confidence level that you can decide? It depends on your business. As I talked about earlier, if it is an airlines industry, if it is a drug pharma industry, what is the acceptable level that you go with? 95%, 90%, and you put people's lives into risk. And right, let's say, for example, you are launching a fruit juice. If the likability is around, I would say, 8 is the mean that I would expect, and it goes at 7, can people live with it? Yes, absolutely. I am fine with it. Because it is not impacting people's lives. Or it is not having a grave concerns. So as a business, you need to decide what is the confidence level that you need to trust it with.
Okay.
Making sense for
the confidence level, then we go for testing of hypothesis, right? I mean, not the reverse.
Sorry, Professor.
We should decide the confidence level we want to live with, then we go for hypothesis testing, right?
Yes, exactly. Your hypothesis testing is sitting on that pillar of confidence level. So now, take that confidence interval. As we talk of the example of Coca-Cola, if your mean of 600 ml is standing in this line at the center, and if I define 10% as my interval, where should that be? 10% of 600 ml would be 60 ml. So it should be operating between 540
to 660.
And 660. So, which is, I define a boundary here as 540 and 660. So any bottle, when I randomly pick a bottle and check how much quantity it has, if it falls in that range of 540 and 650, 660 essentially, so I say that bottle conforms to the normalcy. Otherwise, I have to reject that this bottle is an exception. So that doesn't conform to what the normalcy should be. And these edges that we're talking about, this other side, when you are doing a one-tail test versus when you are doing a two-tail test, operate differently. Because you are taking only one end, and in your confidence interval you are taking on both sides, your confidence level that you are defining will be split into two exact halves. One half is on this side you reject, and the other half on this side you reject. Why we define this exactly as same values?
Because it's a two-tail and it's normal distribution, right?
Yeah, two-tail you look at both, but why should that be exact is my question.
Because the null hypothesis is has an equal to symbol.
Fine, but you can take 0.03 here and 0.02 here, right? Why 0.025 and 0.025?
Standard deviation on both sides should be considered when you right. have 5%.
Right. The simple, very simple reason is this is a symmetric distribution. This is the property of the normal distribution. When it is exactly, it's a mirror image. If you draw a mean line and you fold it, they should be looking exactly the same. That's what a normal distribution tells you. That's why you divide it into exact halves. Is that clear now? Why the application of why a normal distribution should be a bell-shaped and why you should be symmetric in nature. That's the reason. The moment this is not normal, you cannot define exact intervals on both sides. You can consider for your purposes, but it may not be the case also. Is it making sense, folks?
So anything coming in the white region is basically rejection.
Rejection. Yes. Anything in this white region is rejection. So you're rejecting 2.5% values on this side and 2.5% values on this side. And from a probability standpoint, what is the maximum probability you can get?
95%.
Minimum probability you'll get is zero.
Zero.
So it is take mathematically, this whole area under this curve is called is how much? Area under the curve? One,
right. It's
this whole area space under this curve, this is called as the area under curve. It's called as your probability region. So the value has to be between this one and this one. So there is a value of acceptance, value of rejection. Your value of acceptance is nothing but your probability. So in this scenario, your probability is 95%, which is your confidence level. So that's how you connect your probability, your stats, hypothesis tests, everything that you do, and mathematics also. And to do this, you can do integrations, you can do differentiations, you do a lot of calculus around this particular one to get the area under the curve and everything. But that's a different topic. I'm just trying to connect the dots for simplicity. But is this part clear? So this is a two-tail test. When you come down, the same example, you see this whole area is covered under this one. So here you're rejecting only one side. The rejection area is only on one side. So here you took 0.025, 0.025. We are taking 0.05 in this scenario. This is where you say that you have a one-tail test. The bottle has definitely less than 600. So what the company has to prove that the bottle has at least 600 ml. If it is less than 600, you fail it. But what is that acceptable range that you can reject it? So instead of looking at both ends, you take everything at one end primarily. Simple examples that are out there in this one. And then we can jump on to the other topics. See this example for a hypothesis test. A study was done to see the effect of the presence of dogs as pets have on kids, taking the kids in the age group of 10 to 18. So there are two groups of teenagers who have dog. I think they took a sample of how many people, some 10, 15, whatever it is, these people. Then a set of people who do not have a dog. These are samples that they have taken. Now, what is the question do you have? Do dogs have a significant effect, either positive or negative, on the cheerfulness of kids? That's the question. So there is a set of people who have a dog as a pet. There is a set of people who do not have dog as a pet. And the presence of a dog as a pet, will it lead to change in cheerfulness or difference in cheerfulness for the kids? It could be positive cheerfulness. It could be negative, whichever it is. So this is the question that we have. We want to answer this question. So let's start answering these questions. So I think you would have seen on the video, this is the standard template that you will use for doing a hypothesis test. First, you define what is your hypothesis, that is a null hypothesis. Then you define your alternative hypothesis. Then that also includes whether you are defining a right tail test or a left tail test. This go hand in hand. Then you have a one sample test or a two sample test. Then is it a test of means or proportions or variance? Which of this particular one are you dealing with? And then which statistical test do you think is appropriate on this one? These are the questions that we have. Now let's start answering. So what type of hypothesis are we going to create in this one? Now you understood the question, right? Okay. Anyone? Any other thoughts?
I think it is other way around. No dog.
For null, I think, yeah, there is no effect of dogs on kids. That is the null hypothesis.
Good. Actually, what is the norm that we have, which is broadly accepted, is having a dog at home may not have a difference, is the norm that we go. Because we say that there is no difference between two groups whatsoever, is our basic hypothesis. Now you're bringing in one variable or one factor in between and want to measure the impact of this factor. So you feel that already there is a difference, you don't measure what's next. So you assume that there is no difference, then you bring in an element that might cause a variation and say that, okay, now there is a difference between these two, so this factor has a bearing on that one. Are we clear how we are formulating the null hypothesis?
Makes sense. Yeah.
Yeah. So the null hypothesis we go with is there is no difference in the mean happiness or the cheerfulness that is provided for the two groups. People who have dogs as a pet, people who don't have dog as a pet. There is no difference, is our null hypothesis. Then automatically your alternative hypothesis, yes, there is a difference. That's the alternate hypothesis that we go with. Then, now you know what is null. You know what is alternative. It should automatically tell you what it's a one tail, right tail, left tail, or one tail, two tail, what we are trying to do.
Two tail
test, right?
Yes, it's a two tail test.
And that's primarily because it has an equal to
scenario.
Weighting it, yeah.
So if I had put a question like, does it have a positive impact or no bearing? If that was my question, what would have been my null hypothesis?
Null hypothesis would still remain the same, right?
Still remain the same. Then what is my alternative hypothesis?
It would be a one-tail test.
It has a positive impact.
It becomes a one-tail test. Then the question is whether it is a right-tailed or left-tailed.
If it's positive, then it's a right-tailed test.
Right-tailed test, exactly. Good guys, you're catching up, and very nice. So now the question is whether it is a one sample test or two sample test.
It's two samples, right?
It's a two different independent samples that we are dealing with. Good. So next question, is it a test of mean, proportion, variance? What type of test we should use? No. It's a numerical data. I'm capturing
age, right?
It's the means you can calculate on this course.
Mean, yeah.
So it's a test of means essentially. So you do a test of means of independent samples. That's what the test you essentially do on this one. This is how you go with. So average score of kids, mean one, standard deviation one, 7.73, 1.24. But that is with dogs. Without dogs, you calculate again the mean and standard deviation. So the difference between the two means, essentially. Sorry, the difference between A and B is 0.10, which is essentially, where is it coming from? One second. Yeah, that's what I was wondering, essentially. 0.01. Which is the difference between two standard deviations going on. Yeah. So, okay. So now your null hypothesis is essentially pets have no effect. Pets have an effect on this particular one. Alpha we defined as 0.05. Then T critical is a calculation using this formula. M1 minus M2. Essentially. So then under square root of S1 square. S1 is the standard deviation for the first one. S2 is the standard deviation for the second one. Then N1. A sample size of first one and to a standard size of second one. So you get a t-statistic value of 0.35. So what is this telling? how do we interpret this t statistic? Table, you will get the t value. Once you calculate it, you do this, or through different means you can get the tables. But what does the table tell me? What are my general levels of significance levels we are looking at?
5%, right? So 0.05.
So which means, what is the confidence interval I should have?
95%.
For 95%, what is the value, corresponding value of a t statistic? That's what you should compare against. Yeah. So for a 90%, you will have 1.645. For a 95%, you will have 1.96. And for 99%, you will have 2.58. Those are three values I think you should have back of your mind always. So if you compare against that particular one, if this value is greater than plus 1.96 or less than minus 1.96, because you are doing a two-tailed test. So you're doing plus or minus 1.96 is the range, minus 1.96 to plus 1.96. Is this value lying in that range or outside of this range?
Within that range, right?
Yeah, within that range. So you don't reject. If it is falling within the range, you accept it. Isn't it the case? If it falls within this range,
we accept
in the sense, we should not say accept technically. We fail to reject the null hypothesis. Is what we should say. There is no acceptance per se. So we don't reject the null hypothesis. So as a result, so what does that mean, we fail to reject the null hypothesis? There might be a difference between two groups. We don't know. We cannot just prove that. That's all. Benefit of doubt.
With this sample, we couldn't reject null hypothesis.
Exactly. Exactly. That's what this problem is. Clear this hypothesis test, how we do?
What is the T critical there, Ram? Plus minus 2.11.
So if you get plus 2.11, yeah, good question. Sorry. The values that I were referring to was a Z test, not a T test. Now, very good point, Prasad, actually. So what is the number of samples that we are looking at? What is this one? How many values we have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, maybe less than 15, 20, roughly, approximately.
Right.
But this group and this group. So that's a small group we have. We don't have a huge sample size. We're dealing with a small sample size. So when your small sample size is less, it cannot be normal distribution.
Right.
Then you can't use a Z statistic. You have to go with a T statistic. As I said, if you remember earlier, with the T statistic, we try to make some assumptions and make the measurement a little stringent, essentially. So for a normal 95%, we should have looked at a confidence value of 1.96. Thanks for bringing it. But for a t-test, for a t-statistic, it ranges around plus 2.11. If it is a z measurement, when it is a normal distribution completely, z distribution, you could have lived with 1.96. But for this one, the range has increased from 1.96 to 2.11. So it is actually 0.15 more. The range. So you are making the measurement more stringent to reject anything. Because you have less sample, you cannot conclusively reject.
I mean, if it is above or below 2.11, then only we can reject.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. Thanks for pointing out that 2.11. I actually missed that point. Anyone? Any questions?
Ram, when do you decide the sample size is very small? I mean, is there any...
I think if you followed the videos, they would have mentioned about where the thing changes essentially. So normally 30 is the at least base number that you should look at as a sample size to ensure that you are hitting the normality assumption. But 30 is not exactly that you have a normal distribution. It depends on your population. Let's say, for example, how many customers visit my website, and if I go with 30, do you think that will give you the reasonable estimate?
No.
Million customers might be visiting my website every day, and if I just go and operate on a base of 30, it is not at all representative on this thing related to my population. So I should be really looking at hundreds and thousands so that I can confirm, definitely say that my data would be normal, and I can follow the normal assumptions. But if my population itself is only around 70, 80, 100, 150, 200, maybe 30 could be a reasonable number that we go with. But statistically, following the central limit theorem, all calculations and magic that goes behind it, 30 is that magical number where all people believe that you can apply start applying a normal distribution on your data, then this 2.11 will become 1.96. If you had data points of not instead of 16, you had 17 data points should have been there, because degrees of freedom is 16. So you know how to calculate degrees of freedom? It's n minus 1. Simply, if your sample size is n, degrees of freedom is n minus 1. So now, Prasad, you are talking about the table. If you go to the t table on the clocks table that is out there, the logarithmic tables and everything, if you look at a t distribution data, you look at 16 as the degrees of freedom, and at 95% confidence interval, you get the t value as 2.11.
Okay, so because there are 17 samples, so
17 samples, so it is n minus 1, so your degrees of freedom is 16.
And for 95% confidence,
confidence interval, you look at that.
End of the day, any sample, analyze them so that we can bring in these numbers to make some inferences. Am I correct?
Yes, absolutely. This is how you go ahead with a t-test with two samples, which mostly is the scenario that we apply. So this is explanation of the same thing. The test we just performed is called as a two-sample t-test or independent samples t-test or students t-test. These are called students tables, as I was telling about the clocks tables, and everything is called as a students tables. So we perform this test to see if there is a statistically significant difference between the means of two groups. The null hypothesis, that is that there is no difference. Alternative hypothesis, that there is a significant difference. To perform this test, we need to apply one independent qualitative variable with two levels and one dependent quantitative variable. That's what we have seen. There is a difference. Cheerfulness is the qualitative variable, and quantitative variable is the scores on that particular one. So let's jump onto the next one. So this is another example. So this is an interesting example to look at. The following example is an income data of blue collar workers who are at the same skill level. There are two groups of workers. Workers of the textile company Lorries & Co. and workers of the general population. We want to check whether the variance in the income of Lorries is higher than general population. I was wondering, spelling, check whether. It is W-H-E-T-H here, sorry. So now the data that we have is mean and variance of a general population. When we say general population, it is your full population, whole population. The mean is 100 and the variance is 16.11. And Lorries population, how many data points you have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. So there are 15 data points that we have. So now how do we go about it? What are the questions? The question what we want to answer is there a variance in the income level of Lorries group higher than general population? So what is the first thing that we should do? Calculate the mean and variance for Lorries group, essentially, right? Once you get those two matrix, the mean and variance, essentially, your step one is done. Now we come to our set of questions that we will answer. Is it a null or an alternative hypothesis? What would be the null and null hypothesis for this?
No variance.
Same.
There null is less than or equal to.
So basically, there is no variance. They are equal. Yeah. That's what we would look at, right?
Yeah.
What is the alternative hypothesis?
Lorries will be greater than the general population.
Exactly. So now what type of a test it is?
Right tail test.
Correct. Right tail test. Now, this is an important question. Is it a test of mean or proportion or variance? Are you sure?
Variance,
right?
So variance.
What we are asking is whether the mean is higher or not. We are asking whether there is a variance in the income levels.
Variance, actually.
It's a test of variance.
Yes, variance.
Now you remember the first point that we made when we started off distributions and the central limit theorem basic hypothesis. The sampling distribution of mean of samples from a given population is normal, but if you take variance,
it's not normal. I think we need to.
So you cannot apply a normal distribution on that data. So what data? What distribution we should apply?
Chi-square.
Chi-square distribution is what you should apply. right? We'll come to the solution to this one, but let's understand what chi-square distribution essentially is. Then we go to solving the problem. Okay. So when we take many samples of the same size from the normal population and find the sample means they follow normal distribution, same point what we have been beaten to death till now. But when we take many samples from the same size of normal population, find sample variances, they do not follow. Instead, they follow something called as a chi-square distribution, which is dependent on degrees of freedom. Degrees of freedom gives you the variation of the distribution. Even now, even here, what you need to remember is higher the degrees of freedom for your data, higher the possibility that it is getting closer and closer to the normal distribution. The same point. It doesn't matter whether it is a normal curve, whether it is a skewed curve, whatever it is, area under curve is always one. So that's a given thing. So let's not bother. The last point, we'll discuss this and then we'll come to this one. So this is how a chi-square distribution looks like. So this is how, if you plot your variance data, like you plotted your means data, it looked like a normal distribution. As the central limit theorem Python program have seen, if you plot variance in that place, you can take this as an exercise when you get that file and start plotting variance in that data. If you plot variance, the variance will come like this. So this is a right tail data essentially. But important point you need to observe is the three different curves they are putting across here. What is the degrees of freedom telling here?
Setting n-1,
right? No. There is a values mentioned there. I'm asking, can you read those values?
5, 10, 15, right? DL.
5, 10, 15. Does this tell you something? Does that ring a bell? There's an intuitive understanding to this one.
As the degree of freedom is increasing, it's getting to become normal.
Bell curve.
Normal, exactly. So that's the point you need to keep in mind. So when you have very high degrees of freedom, it more or less resembles normal to an extent. But the variance, the amount of variance comes down to an extent. The variance is also coming down. You see the length of this thing? So when you have small samples, you tend to have a very high variance. You could probably see that very easily, right? When you have only 10 people who are giving you a rating, calculate the average. For one person, the average keeps changing very highly. But as your sample size goes to 100, 200, 300 and everything, the variation in means moves only at the second decimal, third decimal, that's all. It doesn't make difference in the first decimal at all.
Yeah.
So that's where your normal distribution hypothesis comes into play. That applies for your variance also to look at. But still there is an element of skewness, but that will come down. And your variance will also come down as your sample sizes increase and tend to go towards population. That's the second point you need to keep in mind. Now, the important point. The cumulative probability runs from right to left. In all the normal distribution, we always started at this side. And it says zero. It is the negative side of this one. Then zero, which is the mean, zero mean at the center. Then plus one, plus this thing on this side. But if you are doing a one-tailed test, you assume zero on this side and then you go like this. Whereas, so then the area under the curve is at the end of the day is cumulative probability for you always. For a chi-square test, you start measuring from this side. It starts from right and goes towards left. So zero is on this side and one is on this side. Why so? In which zone you have maximum data points lying?
The left side.
Left side. So that's why it starts on this side. If it has been symmetrical, it doesn't matter which side you start. But in this side, there are fewer data points here and the data points keep on increasing from this side to this side. That's why you go from right to left for the cumulative probability calculation.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So given that this is the chi-square test of variance, one other point in a broader context to keep in mind, chi-square test has two types of tests. One is test of independence, two goodness of fit. But predominantly, the other area where chi-square test can be used is when your data is categorical. When your data is normal, you predominantly use the t-test and z-test and the other world completely. When you have a categorical data, you tend to come to chi-square test. Okay? So now let's solve the problem. Is this concept clear? See, the rest of the thing here is exactly the same. That's why I'm not reiterating. As I said, you have your alpha value, alpha by 2 on this side, alpha by 2 on this side. We took exactly the same thing. But the region this alpha by 2 represents is smaller on this side, whereas this region could be much higher on this side. Because there are fewer values, the tail is longer, so you get a broader region on this side, smaller region on this side.
Ram, you mentioned that you can also use this test for categorical variables.
Yes, yes.
But this is a test of variance. So in categorical variables, how do we calculate variance?
No, you can use for variance. I'm not denying that. But you can use the chi-square test broadly for categorical data also, is what I'm referring. To substantiate my point, you should go back to the last week's videos in distributions and chi-square distribution. There is one video, one table explained there.
We calculate the marginal probabilities.
Huh? Yes, you calculate the marginal probability and build that chi-square table essentially. There you use a chi-square test.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, because it's a categorical variable. It has two levels on x-axis, two levels on y-axis, and you're trying to calculate whether it is significant enough or not. You're trying to apply a chi-square test there. But that does not eliminate using chi-square test of variance here. When it is a variance, you come to chi-square essentially. I'm not saying you use only there, but you use here also. Okay, let's go back to previous slide. So this is the problem, Lori's example. So the total population, mean one, variance one is 116.11, which is already given for us here. And then we calculated the same thing for Lori's group. We got 104 and 40 point. See, the mean is marginally higher, but see the variance that is. Given that this is a broader population, the variance is small actually, because it takes so much of data, variance can be less. When it is only small set of data, you have a much higher variance, the same point what we are talking about. So now n is only 15, that's why you see a much higher this thing. And degrees of freedom correspondingly becomes 14, n minus 1. So now what is your null hypothesis? There is no difference in variation. Both are the same. Alternative hypothesis, Lori's group has a higher variance compared to the general population. And we are doing the test at 95%. So you calculate the chi-square critical value from the tables. There's a chi-square tables in the student's table book that we get. And for this particular one, when you look at the 95% interval or the alpha level of 0.5 and this degrees of freedom, you get 23.68 as your chi-square critical value. Like you got T critical in the previous example, you get chi critical here, just 23.68. So the statistic, the way you calculate essentially is for this data you got, whatever you calculated, chi-square is equal to degrees of freedom of V2 by V1. So this comes to 35.62 essentially.
That is not x-square, right? It's chi-square.
Chi-square. It's not chi-square. Actually, it's a Greek letter, which this line actually goes much longer than this. So they are putting just x-square there, essentially this. So the value you get is 35.62, but the chi-square critical value is 23.62. So your chi-square value is much higher than this. So Lori's group has significantly higher population variance on this one.
Where from we got this 35 is from the fair of that.
Okay. Yeah, degrees of freedom of V2 minus degrees of freedom of V1. The variances. So degrees of freedom into V2 by V1. What is V2? 40.99. V1 is 16.11. So that is 40.99 by 16.11 into degrees of freedom. Your degrees of freedom is 14. That 14. So you do 40.99, which is roughly 41 by 16 into 14, you get close to this value.
And the chi critical is coming from the table, right?
Chi critically comes from the table, essentially, yes. So in with Python and everything, with all these libraries, you don't need to. All these programs throws these at you. Right. So now coming to this one, we did chi-square test of significance, the same formula. Sir, I think I did not go through this one, but I explained the same point. So you draw the lines at the same significance level, you get this longer line and you get a smarter this one, but you get more data points lying in this range. Fewer data points on this one. This is two tail versus this is one tail. Same pieces we touched upon this one, but it's exactly the same thing. Simple concept. The formula. and minus one is your degrees of freedom into variance of your sample by variance of population. So this is a normal x square. This is written, but I think see here you see a different chi square written as a representation, just for reference. Okay. So now you saw the previous example where we took two samples and tried to do the variance. But here, look at this. Three groups of samples of factory emissions of different plants of the same company were collected. The score is computed based on composition of emissions. We want to find out if there is any inconsistency or difference across three groups. Group A, so much data. Group B, group C, the emission data that is coming for three groups. What are we trying to see? Inconsistency or difference? It's not just the means. Inconsistency or difference between three groups. So far, we have been operating with
one or two
samples essentially. Now you are getting into three samples, so the life is becoming more interesting now, which we are tending towards more real world examples here. So can we do any of the regular t tests or other tests that we have been talking so far?
No,
you cannot. So we need to resort to something called as ANOVA. What does ANOVA stand for?
Analysis of variance.
Good point. So when you did chi-square, that is basically meant for two samples there. You did for the variance differentiation between two samples. But when you have multiple samples, so it's not just three. In the previous example that we saw, three, you can go to n number of samples, k number of samples. So analysis of variance, the fundamental hypothesis you go with is all samples that you have the same mean, same variance. That's what it is. Exactly. That's what you the means are same, you analyze variance. If the means are not the same, then there is not much of the variance. See, between mean and variance, it's a good idea to draw something here. Let me go to the whiteboard if I can. Three normally distributed curves, assume so. So can you differentiate between these three curves that are there? What is what? Have any sense? For all the three, the mean is the same. It's the same mean. So all the three normal curves, normal distributions are happening around the same mean, but with varying variance. Understanding this? This is what we do in the analysis of variance. This is sample one. This is sample two. This is sample three. Have the same mean.
Is there an assumption, Ram, in ANOVA that all the means are same for all the populations?
That's what your null hypothesis essentially is. When you know all your, you can calculate the variations in the variance and how it impacts you only when all means are supposed to be the same. That's what your null hypothesis. So automatically the alternative hypothesis is not all population means are equal. Let's say, for example, instead of this, let's take a broader one. For example, let's say for some reason this curve like this, and I have a mean here. What is this? This is another sample. So let's say this is mu 1, mu 2, mu 3, and this is mu 4. What does this prove? Mu 1 equal to mu 2 equal to mu 3, but that is not equal to mu 4.
Right.
In that scenario, my alternative hypothesis comes true because not all population means are equal. Importantly, what you need to keep in mind is it does not differentiate or tell you which is different. It tests whether all are in the same acceptable range or not. If it is not, it will tell you very differently. So for at least one pair, if you are using three samples, it could be A equal to B, A equal to C, B equal to C. It doesn't tell you which is different, but at least one pair has a different means compared to the other one. That's what ANOVA tells you. This is one. So the same problem will come to the solution again, this particular one. So one-way ANOVA, what exactly it is? So the one-way ANOVA is used to, so the ANOVA has two types. It is one-way or two-way. Actually, there is something called as MANOVA also, multi-way ANOVA. But for the sake of simplicity, keeping things into the simple under the carpet for now, you don't use MANOVA in majority of the scenarios, so don't bother about MANOVA. Only you need to ANOVA. And ANOVA is also, knowing theoretically, what you are important to know is the F-test that comes into play, the F-value. This primarily you use when you are doing a regression. Linear regression, when you do, this F value comes into play. And when we talk of linear regression, then we'll get a little deeper with ANOVA on understanding how the ANOVA value makes sense. But the fundamental concept is you have a higher F value, which is significant. That is important for you to go ahead with regression. If you don't have a significant F value, you don't do regression. That's the base amount of information you need to remember. Okay. But in real life scenarios, majority of the times you don't end up using much of ANOVA, essentially, other than that. So the one-way analysis of variance is used to determine whether there is any statistical significant differences between the means of two or more independent groups. That's what we discussed. And for this way, this ANOVA, the ratio between the group variability to within the group variability follows an F distribution. So let's say how many groups we are taking here. Let's take this example for. How many groups we are looking at?
Three
groups. So the variability within these groups versus variability across the groups. Within A, within B, within C, how is the variability? Versus between A and B, A and C, B and C, how is the variability? That's the point that we are talking about here. Just to quickly. Based on that, you try and plot those variances into a graph format. That distribution is called as a F distribution. When you use two samples and drawn a distribution, what distribution you ended up with? Variance of just two samples, you ended up with chi-square distribution. When you use multiple groups like that, you end up with a F distribution. And your null hypothesis is same as there is no variance between the thing. Alternative hypothesis is there is a difference between that particular one. At least one pair. Okay. So that's the thing. So then each of these things calculates by the formulas. So let's start with this example. Are you clear with the concept? It is as simple as that. You calculate the variation within the group and across the groups. And then you divide one by the other. Then you get the F score. If that F score is, again, there is an F table kind of a thing. That F table with the given degrees of freedom will tell you a F statistic. And if that F statistic is, your calculated value is higher than the F statistic that you're getting from the table, it is significant. Otherwise, it is not significant. The logic and process is exactly the same. We'll do that here. So degrees of freedom between K minus 1 is equal to 3 minus 2. So how many, K is nothing but the number of samples, right? You have A, B, C, three groups.
Right.
So 3 minus 1 is 2. That is degrees of freedom between. Degrees of freedom within. So what is N? In total, how many values you have?
Total of all three groups
together. All three groups together, how many values you have? 59. And minus K, number of groups that you have. 59 minus 3 is equal to 56. So the total degrees of freedom is nothing but degrees of freedom between plus degrees of freedom within, which leads to 58. For the above degrees of freedom, F critical is equal to 3.161. As I said, you get the F table. From the table for this degrees of freedom, for the given confidence level that you are looking at, you get a F critical value of 3.161. Now the rest of the process begins. So mean value of A group, this much, B is this much, C is this much. So on the visual observation, do you think is the means the same?
No, 41 is much less than
that. Misleading, right? This is completely off the place. Other two are certainly somewhat closer. So now overall mean is, take all the values, total sum divided by this is 48.64. Even the overall mean is going on this side, but B is way off, essentially. Now you called sum of squares of total, this thing is equal to the same way you calculate the means, xi minus overall mean. Xi is you take each of the 59 values that are there minus the overall mean, which is your 48.654 square, and add up all of those sum of squares, comes to this particular one. This is the total. Then you calculate within for group A, group B, group C, you calculate the mean differences and square and add up them, the sum of squares. This is what you get. And sum of squares within, between the groups. So you calculate the total within and between. Between is nothing but total minus within is equal to this much. You just substitute that into the formula. So the mean squares between is equal to SS between by degrees of freedom, this much. So the same for between, within, you calculate this. And F statistic is nothing but MS between by MS within. Your 5.73 versus what is the value that we got here? Critical value? 3.6161. So 5.73 is higher than 3.161. So it is significant. So we reject the null hypothesis. And even by visual observation, we saw that this is very different from this particular one. Just if you want to do an exercise, when this file is shared with you, change this one from 41 to some 53 or 49 or something, and then do the exercise, then it would be interesting how close this 3.161 versus these values would come to. It's an exercise you can try.
Sure.
So, Ram, on this one, we don't have any like intervals or you know those other things that we discussed about in the...
No.
So, most of the time, wouldn't we be rejecting the null hypothesis because we wouldn't be near the mean?
Wouldn't be near... See, there are two ways to look at this whole confidence level, confidence interval pieces. The one that we talked about, let me go here. Yeah. So, this way, what were we calculating here? This whole area is under one is what we decided. Are we good with that?
Right. Yeah.
So, this distribution can be interpreted in two ways. One, with your actual mean, whatever you're calculating. Let's say, for example, you're calculating this on the likability score or whatever you call. I'm going back to my old example, my favorite example for the day. Let's say your average is around 7.5 coming to be here. Right?
Right.
Now, one standard deviation, my standard deviation, let's say, is 0.5. What would be one standard deviation?
0.5.
0.5. So it comes to 7 and 8, right? And if I take two standard deviations?
It's 1.
6.5 and 8.5.
8.5.
Right? That's two standard deviations. Three standard deviations, 6 and 9.
Right.
Right? So, but at the end of the day, what are the intervals that I'm getting at? Always a value which is in reference to my mean.
Right.
So you always need to convert that back to your original value if you are looking from the actual mean perspective. And when you are dealing with multiple samples, like we are looking at this, at least your ANOVA, you are trying to do here for all the attributes, similar type of attributes in this example. Okay, all are referring to the same emission related metrics. So it doesn't make much of a difference. But when I do a regression analysis, like who was talking about regression earlier? We said that Chaitanya, was that you for electrical vehicles?
Yeah, beginning of the class.
In the beginning, we touched on electrical vehicles, right? What are the factors that influence my projections for electrical vehicle purchase probably once I go into production mode or launch mode? How much people are buying electrical vehicles? And whether the fuels are available, whether the service stations are available, how is the market for this particular one outside? I take n number of factors, but number of service stations available is in its own metric. Fuel stations available is its own metric. No metric is in connection with the other metric. You understand there are two different metrics completely.
Yeah.
Right.
Are you understanding that concept there?
Yeah.
And now if I have to compare, if there is a mean variation within the electric, the fuel stations available or electric charging stations to be precise for that particular one, and the number of service stations available versus number of outlets available,
mm-hmm.
I take all of these, each of these things is in its own metric, each of is its own units. There is no way I can compare within the means, between the means, all these formulas I cannot calculate. I was able to calculate all these things because it's exactly the same metric across all the three groups.
Correct. I mean, right?
So what we essentially do there is we convert this particular thing into a Z distribution. What is a Z distribution?
We don't know the sigma, right?
No, Z distribution is all about zero mean and one standard deviation.
How many standard deviations?
Not one standard, unit standard deviation is what we look at. So you convert whatever the mean value you have as zero. And all the variations you plot across as a standard deviation value. So the scale earlier you have, let's say for example, your mean was 7.5. This scale could have become anywhere between 0 and ended at 10. Because my scale was 0 to 10 or 1 to 10, whatever I'm using. So that's why I have a 7.5 value. But what I do is I do something called as a Z transformation. The video talks about Z transformation, if you remember. How does the Z transformation is calculated? Anybody?
It is how many standard deviations my value is from, right? It's how many. It's variance divided by the standard deviation. So.
Yes. So the formula for that one, I think we covered that formula today also earlier. It is x bar minus mu by sigma
by
over root n, over square root of n. That's the standard deviation conversion. So that formula you apply for your mean and this whole distribution. For every value that is out there, you apply that formula. The moment you do that, this becomes the mean becomes a zero. Earlier it was 7.5, that becomes zero. And all these things would be on the scale of standard deviations. Similarly, every variable that you have, you convert into that format. Then you do an ANOVA on those data, the normalized data.
Yes, Ram, but the question is the F critical is dependent on what, basically?
It's a table. The F critical is for that particular degrees of freedom, for that particular confidence level that you are looking at, there is a fixed value that is out there.
The confidence level and degrees of freedom, right?
Yes. Oh, it was just that much question. My question, my understanding was if you are using different variables. For some reason, I was totally...
No. So my primary question was, it looks like, I mean, if we don't have the confidence intervals or anything that is being applied for ANOVA, then almost every time we would be rejecting the null hypothesis.
Yeah, exactly, Bruno. That's what I was even thinking. But as Ram clarified, this F critical 3.161 has also confidence level, right? It's not mentioned here.
It's a confidence level.
That's correct. Yeah. Maybe that's the point that I missed.
Yeah. It's a confidence level that you take at what confidence level you draw that. And then... You do this.
Right. Maybe this one 3.161 is at 95% confidence level. Maybe.
Yeah. I will come back to this, but that's my way of looking at the things, but I'll answer this question. I'll take that as a homework and I'll come back. Okay, so this has another example exactly on the same lines. So a study found that as of 2015, the world population of 7.7 billion, so many billions are diagnosed with HIV positive. Of 1.3 billion Indians, 2.1 million are diagnosed positive. So this is a population mean and population, this particular one, this is with respect to India. So how do we do this analysis on this one? Null hypothesis is the population of AIDS significantly different in India to that of the world. So if you look at 1.3 over 2.1 versus 7.7 over 36.7, you can get roughly what is the proportion that you are getting it. But are they significantly different or more or less they are in the same range? That's the hypothesis. So again, you go with proportion of AIDS in this particular one. So 0.0047 in the world, you calculated the difference. This thing is 47%. Proportion of AIDS in India is 16%. So you calculate the Z statistic. P sample 0 minus P sample. Okay, this is not the... Sorry, I think the ordering of these slides were different, I suppose. This is basically test of proportions. We covered test of means, test of variance, but test of proportions we did not cover. So this is test of proportions. So basically calculate proportions. So this is a Z statistic. P sample minus P population that is out there. So 16 minus 47 by 16 minus 47 divided by the total population out there. That is N, essentially, which comes to your 65.68. So that is, if this value you calculate the Z statistic, this is significantly higher, significantly different. I won't call higher, significantly different from the world population. I mean, you're just looking at the proportions, you can see that 16% is, 0.16% is significantly different from 0.47%. But just this higher statistic. So even if you take three standard deviations also, the value is somewhere around for three standard deviations. 2.58, but here you are getting minus 65.68. So take that as plus or minus 2.58. It is way beyond that particular value. So it is significantly different. That's what it means. So that's an example for test of proportions. The only piece is, let's say they're comparing between world, which has the population parameters, and India. And let's say, for example, tomorrow you compare India against China and you got China numbers. How do you do that? So there is a slightly different formula for that. Basically, what you do is proportion of India minus proportion of China divided by proportion of India minus into 1 minus proportion of India divided in multiplied by proportion of China into 1 minus proportion of China divided by 1 by n square plus India sample size square plus China sample size square. So that's the formula essentially comes. So don't bother, there is a formula available everywhere. You do a z-statistic using Python file, you will easily get that. But that's how you calculate. Instead of comparing against the population, you compare against another sample. The formula slightly changes of calculation for proportion on that.
So in this tutorial, we have learned about sampling theorem and the central limit theorem intuitively. And if you want to learn more conceptual course like this, please go to our Great Learning Academy platform where you will get almost 80 plus free courses. And after complete your course, you can claim your certificate as well. Thank you very much for attending the tutorial.